In this video, I'm going to illustrate doing unit testing in Python. I'm going to do this in Python because it's one of the most popular languages in bioinformatics, but really you can do this in any language, and really you should be doing this. But I'm going to do this from the ground up to show that unit testing is quite simple to do, and illustrate how you can do it. And for this project, I'm going to create a program to filter a FASTQ file. And I'm going to do this from scratch. So first of all, I'm going to create a directory, filter. And I'm going to put my code in the directory FASTQ filter and put my test code in test. And because this is a Python project, I need to touch the file init underscore py in my FASTQ filter folder just so I can load it. Now, if I want to create a test file, I can put this in the test directory, and my test file should begin with test underscore. And that's the convention for testing files. And then any files that begin with that will be run. So this file I'm going to create is going to be called test underscore FASTQ filter. Hi. So if I now edit this, and I need to import my test framework, which is going to be nose tools import everything. And so that's going to import all the testing tools. And then from my program, I'm going to write FASTQ filter import star, and I haven't written anything in here yet, but that's where it's going to be. And actually, I should create this, should be in a file which I call run. So if I create here, I create touch FASTQ filter run.py, and so if I go back to this one here, so that's that file I've just created there. So from FASTQ filter.run import everything, and that file is here. So FASTQ filter run, FASTQ filter run, and because I have this init.py, it can load that file. And so the first thing I want to do is test filtering a FASTQ. So if I put in here test is read good. And this is a method. And just as before, I created a file which was test underscore. Any method which is test underscore will be run in the tests. And so if I just put none in here, so I'm leaving this intentionally empty. But then if I go back here and go to filter, and it's nose test. So it ran one test, and then that's this test here. And I can, for example, make a failing test. For example, if I assert equal 1, 2, and that's testing that 1 equals 2, which obviously will fail. I can run that again, and you can see here it fails. Assertion error, 1 does not equal 2. And so that's like the basics of how you write tests, but obviously this is not a very interesting test. So now I'm going to write something that's relevant to what I'm doing. So if I create an example, say good read, and if you're not familiar with a FASTQ file, what FASTQ looks like is something along these lines where you have, imagine this is just, actually maybe I'll just create a blank file for this. So imagine this is a FASTQ file. You have a @, which is the FASTQ header, and that would be some ID in here. Then you have some DNA sequence, something like this. And then a delimiter, and then some quality scores, which are in ASCII. So it looks something like this. So basically, it's just each FASTQ entry is a read of ID, some DNA sequence, a delimiter, and then the quality scores, which are ASCII values. So if I go back to here, a good read should have an ID. So I'm going to create this as a Python array, some sequence, a delimiter, and then some ASCII values. But for purpose of this tutorial, I'm just going to assume that I've automatically already transformed those ASCII values into integers. So I'm just going to put an array of quality scores in like this. So that's 5. If I go back here, I can just so that's 20 quality scores there. So that's my kind of dummy FASTQ file, FASTQ read. And I want to test my function where we say that that's good. So is good read, which is the name of my function. And I might say 20. My good read. Right, that's my function, and I want to assert that returns true, which I believe is assert true. Now, what I want my function to do is good read, is to determine, given a function in my FASTQ sequence, so maybe actually I'll change that to say 10. Say position 10 has a FASTQ score greater than 20. So what I'm saying to my function is, at position 10 in my sequence, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, here, is the quality score greater than 20? So here it's 40, so and here I'm passing the read. So this should return true because this sequence, the 10th position, has a quality score greater than 20. So that's my first unit test. So if I run that now, now that's going to fail because I haven't written this function yet. So now, knowing what I need this function to do, I can now go and write it. So if I edit filter, and I need to write this function, def is good read position quality score read. So this is the function definition, and then this should return true. So let me just say that it returns none first. What does that do if I repeat this? That's good. No, I made a mistake there. So I put good read. So it should be good read. Repeat that. So now it's saying none is not true. That's because it's not returning the value it expects. So if I change that to return true, it now passes the test because it returns true. Now that's not very useful because it's not doing any tests. So now I can, for example, create a bad read. And now let's say change 40. 20. Oops. So now, oh, no, actually, I don't want to change that. I'll change that to 15. So now I have a read where my quality scores are 15. And because I want to check that position 10 around here somewhere is greater than 20, this should, I want this to return false now. So if I run my test, say true is not false. So now my method is not working. So now I actually have to write my method. So I can do that by doing, so I can decompose my read this way. So because this is an array with four values, I can decompose this. And if you're not familiar with this Python syntax, let me just demonstrate it. So say I have an array of 1, 2, 3. Obviously, if I put this in here, v equals 1, so that's v. Now if I do a, b, c equals v, now a contains a value 1, b contains a value 2, c contains a value 3. So what I'm basically doing is v has three values, and each of those values gets put in each of these variables. And if the number of variables doesn't quite match the number of values, you'll get an error. So they must match. Too many values to unpack. So that's just what I'm doing here. This is, I'm exploding my array out, and but this is the end I'm really interested in. And my test is return qualities at position is greater or equal to quality score. Mm-hmm. Let's see if that works. All right. True is not false. It's good read. 10, 20. Ah, okay, I'll put this in here. Bad read. Yeah, so they both work now. And I can break this, for example, greater than 100, just to show you that it should fail. So if I accidentally break my method, now my tests should show that breaking. So that's the advantage of having tests, because every time I change something, I can rerun my tests and make sure that it works. And so that's all the basic points are for writing unit tests. Every time you write a method, you can just write some tests using assert to on whatever values you want to test to make sure that they match your expectations. So I'll just carry on now, and illustrating this a bit more just to show how this can be used. Now say I want to run my tests regularly, so I'm going to create a make file, and in that I'm going to do create a task called test. This, which is just going to run this command nose test. Nose. So now if I go make here, it runs that. So that's not very interesting. But what I can do is I often have this target called make dev test. Now, if you're not familiar with how make files work, if I write a task like this, whenever I call that to task, that command will get run. So here's an example, echo hello. So now if I run this, so I go down here, make, paste the name of my command in, that's what gets run. So this is matching, and this is just command line. So what I'm going to do is use a command which I quite like called fs watch. I don't know if this has a help file or not. I guess not. But I can illustrate what this does. So fs watch test, which is the name of my directory here, test. So watch that directory, and whenever that directory gets changed, run the command clear and make tests. Now, if you're not familiar with the command clear, all that does is clear the contents of the screen. And then so it clears the screen and then runs the tests. So let me illustrate what that does. Make dev test. Right, so it runs that command. So now if I edit my test file, it runs that command, you see? So if I were to break this, I should see that straight away. So if I change this to say 10, it reruns that and it says, you got an error here. This is not true. So I can automatically get feedback on my tests as I'm writing them. So I'm just going to edit my menu file. So I want to, I also want to watch the FastQ filter directory too. So if I go back there, FastQ filter run. And if I change this one, I should, oh no, I need to restart that. Mm-hmm. So if I go back here, this file changed and it runs those again. So that's nice, because now I say I want to refactor this. So this line here is a little bit redundant, because I can actually destructure this inside here, put that in ID sequence delim and qualities. Okay. Repeat that, and that works. And if you're not familiar with that, what this line here does is destructure that read into these, as I illustrated before. But now I can actually just move that up into here, so it gets dynamically destructured in the method call, which simplifies this method a bit. And my tests run, so I know that this works. So before I finish, let me just write one more method to illustrate writing tests. So given what, I can test the read is good, but what if I want to sort of filter a list of reads? So test filter reads. So here is a my method I'm going to test, filter reads. Put 9 here for the moment, leave that empty. And I'm going to make these a global variable. Going to call this good. I'm going to call this bad. Right, so I've moved these to variables called good and bad. And because I've renamed these, but I haven't renamed them here, then that should fail. And because I have unit tests, that should get caught. And you should see that straight away. See, so I automatically see straight away that this is not defined, which is nice because I can edit quickly and get feedback without having to rerun it. So what I do is I change this here to good and change this here to bad, and that should work again. Good name bad, it's not described. Oh yeah, let me change this here. Yeah, okay, so now I have some good and bad reads I can work with. And what I want my method to do, so right here I'm going to just doing true or false. Now I want to set assert equals. So say I have the sequence of reads, good, good, good. So 3 good reads in an array. If I do my method filter reads on those, what I should see is the same reads out again. Right, because they're all good reads, and so if I filter them, I should get exactly the same reads at the other end. So if I go here, paste that in here, and I just do assert equal, which just tests for equality. Okay, put the matching parentheses. So what it is filter reads good, good, good should return good, 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 right? And now it's complaining that this doesn't exist. So I can just, I need to implement that method now. So e.sqfilter1. So now I need to write this extra method, def filter reads. And I can just implement a simple method here. And that just returns them, okay? But obviously that doesn't do what I want because I actually want to do some filtering. So if I go back now here, if I have, say for example, a bad read in the middle, then I should only see two good reads because I want this bad read to be filtered out. Okay? And it's seeing first extra element two saying that this is not what you expect. So now I need to go back and implement this. So say for example, I write good reads equals this for I in reads. If is good read are good reads append are, and then here I think it's return good reads. Does that work? Good reads, oh yeah. So it's position 10 and a quality score of 20 or more. Oh no, put that in the wrong. Okay, so that works. Great. So now that that just illustrates how you can write unit tests. Okay. So let's say for example I wanna creating an array and constantly appending methods to it is not very efficient. So maybe I want to do return, some functional programming, return filter lambda. So here R, lambda R. Here I. Reads. Does that still work? Yeah. So if you're not familiar, I just converted this to a functional program, a functional method. So each read, it just runs this lambda, which is good read. And if I wanted to be really fancy, I could get rid of the lambda, I think, from func tools import. Partial, I think this works. So partial is good read. Fingers crossed this works. I think that's it. Yeah, it's nice. So that's even simpler. So what this is doing is creating a partial function with these two methods filled in and then just doing the repeat filter. But as you can see, the whole time I don't need to, I can see if it works or not, just because these get run all the time. Actually, I wonder if I can, let me try one more thing. I wonder if I can create this as a partial function too. I'm not sure if we can do this in Python, but don't know if this will work. Oh yeah, this does work. So you can do that in Python, which is nice because I know that this works because my tests pass. Okay, so I think that's a nice example to finish with, showing that you can feel much freer to play around with your code, because as long as your unit tests pass, then you know that your code works. Thanks.